Welcome back. So let's talk about hyperparameters, shall we? This is basically the first steps into learning how to actually train a neural network. Of course, we've seen how to do it on the exercise. We know how to do it in a bunch of lines, but there are some little details and there are things that we need to know, as in what can you change to make your model more accurate or faster or deal with some problems. So this whole module is about that. We're going to first see in this lesson what options there are, what can you change about neural networks, what are the knobs and buttons that you can push and pull and twist. This is going to be kind of like a summary, and then we're going to go over one by one the problems that neural networks face. So this could be that they take a long time to train, unstable gradients problem, or overfitting, for example, or underfitting. And we're going to see one by one how we can tweak the settings that we're going to see in this lesson to make them better or solve these problems. But as I said, this one is going to be kind of like a summary. This is a diagram I made to kind of make a summary of what are all the hyperparameters. So these are all the hyperparameters, all the things that you can change, so kind of like settings, and how they work together, so that, you know, if you want to recall and remember what we talked about in this lesson, you can refer back to this image. I will leave a PDF version. That will be a PDF version attached in the lesson. So below, under, somewhere above this video, you should be able to find it. All right. So let me first explain to you what's happening here. In a neural network, we of course set up the neural network, right? What happens is we want to divide our data set into batches. Dividing it into batches means deciding how many data points you want in one group, that is one batch, and then dividing your data into groups of that many data points. You can decide that your batch size is going to be equal to the amount of data that you have, then you will only have one batch. But let's say we divided our data into four batches, right? What happens is, how this whole system works is, we talked about this before, but I want to give you a brief explanation again. We give one batch of data, so this could be 32 data points, 64 data points, something like that, into our model. It gets read in the input. It is passed, these calculations are done using this calculation. It is passed, the outputs are passed to the next layer. The outputs of that layer is passed to the next layer. And depending on how many layers we decided to have and how many neurons we decided to have, it goes all the way until the output layer. Once we have outputs, once we have first predictions, we have to, of course, learn, right? So what happens is we also get the actual values that the predictions were supposed to be, and then we calculate a loss. And to do that, we use a loss function. And this loss function can be changed. In the exercise, we were using the sparse cross-entropy loss, but this will depend on your problem, but we'll talk about it in a second. Once the loss is calculated, what we do is we calculate through backpropagation how much each of these weights and biases that the neurons have affect the outcome. And once we know that, we have a graphic like this, where based on the weight, we know how the loss will change. But of course, then it will be how 3D, 4D, 5D, or however many parameters you have D graphic, and then we will have this there. And what we do is, using the optimization algorithm decides which way you should go. Because of course, when it's a many-dimensional graph, it's not as easy as looking at it and saying, oh yeah, minimum goes this way and lower it. But yeah, it's not easy because it's going to be a lot of dimensions. That's why we use optimization algorithms to tell us which direction this parameter, this weight or bias, needs to be turned or tweaked into, so that we will get a better loss or a lower loss. Once we know the direction, we also need to know how far we need to go in one direction. And that's where learning rate comes in. So learning rate tells us how long to go, but we'll talk about it again in a second in this lesson. Once this is done, backpropagation uses this information to update all the weights and biases and we come back here. And then we do the same thing for the next batch. We do some predictions, make some predictions, calculate the error, optimization algorithm backpropagation calculates how much each of the weights and biases affected the error, optimization algorithm decides which direction to go, learning rate tells us how far in that direction to go. And then we do it again. And once we run through all these batches, let's say we only had four, once we run through four of the batches, did the same thing for four of them, we have gone through the whole data set. So that means we've completed one epoch. And you might want to go more than one epoch, which is basically the standard way. You never run through your data only once. And that's where what we call the number of iterations. So as I said, first we run through the first batch, calculate the error, update the weights, second batch, do the same thing, third batch, do the same thing, as many batches as you have. And that only completes one run through our data. So if you remember from the exercise, we were getting lines, right, while the network was training. So each of these lines that were created told us that that was one epoch. We trained our model with 30 epochs, but you can change that number, of course. One other thing here that we haven't mentioned yet is regularization. Regularization is kind of like an extra thing that you can do on top of your network to eliminate some of the neurons. Then you might say this neuron, and this neuron should not give any outputs. We will see more about that later. And the last thing is weight initialization. We will again talk about that, but it's basically once you set up your neural network all the way at the beginning, before you train or anything, how should you set these weights and biases so that you get the maximum accuracy, or we'll see, we'll talk about it in the next lessons. It will help us solve some of the problems. So don't forget to go grab this PDF. Also, after that, let's go a little bit more further into all of these things. I'll tell you how to set them, or kind of give you an idea of what they are.